Delta's already gone back. This is, they've gone back once for the initial,
right.
Then again.
Right.
So someone does need to go back and take a cursory overview, and we can determine who that is when they're finished, which sounds like it won't be until after our office meeting.
So the first time they went back and took a look after repairs were made, right? They made repairs and then Delta went and looked at the repairs,
yes.
And found other and found issues with it?
It was a punch list of things that weren't completely correct the way they should be.
And we paid for that.
We paid Delta additional funds to, to do another study.
Okay. And we're gonna have to do it again.
We can have Delta do it.
Well, we should do it again. Let's put it that way. We found some issues the first time, and we'll do it again. So we can really get it right.
Right.
Let me jump on the issues that Delta found. Okay. What they found was they took a picture of there and seen there's a crack in the wall. They took care of that crack in the wall. Okay. But they didn't go around the building and look at other cracks. Well, Delta came back out and inspected. So there's more cracks in the building. You need to take care of them. So that was one. That's one of the major items. Some of the other items they had pictures of, we rectified to compliance, but they feel it's still not rectified to their compliance. So our maintenance team's worked with basically them, Delta, and showing them that it's been compliant to satisfaction. So we've worked through that, and that's gonna be the next report that's gonna be coming out.
Okay. Any other discussion on that?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of items that Delta did not look at, and one of the things that was mentioned is the furniture. We need to plan in our reserve study, because all of our furniture is going to need to be placed in these buildings. Most of the furniture, my understanding, is at least 15 to 17 years old. Most of the chairs are not comfortable to sit on. A lot of them are dirty, some of them are broken. Same thing with the tables. When we play cards in the card room, it's horrible on them. And the ballroom, everybody was disappointed we didn't have new chairs when they redid that.
Let me jump in real quick. And I'm going to go back to the budget. The upcoming meeting in August. Tables and chairs and stuff like that, typically you do an operation expenditures on reserve, unless it's a huge amount, okay, then you can look at doing reserve. But taking care of chairs and something you budget for, doesn't have to be a reserve expense.
Replacement of chairs? Do we have an idea what the expense would be to replace?
About $80,000 you look like for to take care of these chairs for a comfort ballroom chair and the tables and all the stuff where you do them all.
We can do all these chairs in this room for $80,000.
$80,000.
And is that in the budget somewhere?
That's not in this budget, no. It's not this budget.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
If we have some significant numbers. The other thing is the IBM, IBM Wi-Fi equipment. A lot of the clubs have chosen not to do things because they can't anymore. Like the book club has decided not to do Skype calls anymore because they can't depend on the Wi-Fi in the building. There's problems with connections here, problems with connections in the palms. Our clubs are choosing not to do things because we don't have the proper equipment.
Yeah, most of your issues there are through Spectrum and Bryant House and droplet failure. You guys know this as most of the people. The Wi-Fi signal, you have a commercial router, Meraki routers, they're top of the line. So I can sit down with you and talk and discuss that more with you. You can sit down with our chief information officer, who goes through the detail with you and show you why. But in general, as far as operational costs, guys, if we can hold off until, and you guys can ask me an email via email, I can answer any questions in the budget, anything like that. One thing I want to say to you guys, and I want to say this before I get off the podium here and pretty much end this discussion on the budget side, the tax savings that you're going to have in that operating budget, plus other things in that budget, that I've basically, so the gentleman came to talk about capital reserve expenditures and kind of stuff like that. I've talked to some of the youth supervisors about, we do have line items that do take care of some of those items. And it's basically the maintenance, the O&M and maintenance. So if we have an AC go down, it's in there. Okay, it's not a reserve line item, it's in there. I also did a quick calculation. I was looking at the pre-funding of 80 homes for the first year assessments. You will have in your reserve about $100,000 to $110,000 paying one in reserves from 80 homes. So that would be basically your cash flush of reserves in day one for 80 homes.
What we need is, when you're doing a capital improvement budget, you need to get a sense of all the items that should be in that budget. We need to have some kind of an idea of what that total cost
is. We have that. If you look at your budget notes, it's in there. So some of those items are in there. If you look at the different line items that are categorized in there, they will have what is for next year. Do we have the tables and chairs in there?
I don't want an annual, but we need a long-term capital plan.
Correct.
We don't have one.
I will go through that with you in the next meeting with the reserve study, okay? Now, something I'm gonna do today, I didn't have the time, we're pushing to August, okay? I have that all detailed out for you. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna line up my line item and all the equipment that is there in our facilities, and we're gonna show how much useful life is left, where it's at in the budget. That's gonna give you your plan. I also told the supervisors, is once you guys do, this purchase does go through, once it does go through, you need to do a reserve study. And now the reserve study with an independent firm, it could be one of the ones we've used, it could be Delta Command, EFG, whoever it may be, come back in and work with our team, work with the supervisors, take a couple from the supervisors, work with them and go through each line item and see what the actual useful life of that piece of equipment is. There's a huge discrepancy between the two companies right now as far as cost, useful life, all kinds of stuff. We need to get them down to where you go through that. Right now they're taking off the computer and punching it out. We can get a good roadmap going forward, but we gotta get another company come in here and sit down with our maintenance team, go through each of the facilities, look at the chairs, look at the tables, look at the carpet, look at everything in here, and give you a realistic line item of budget for them.
I don't like a mystery number. We should know that we are gonna be in a situation where we're maxing out our debt capacity, which means if we do not properly plan the reserve funds, if we do not know what we are gonna need in reserve funds, we are going to be in a position of having to break the promise of holding that debt fee level for 30 years. Because we're going to have to borrow. So we need to know. We need to know long term what kind of capital planning we need to do for all these things, and we have no numbers.
You do have numbers. Let me say this. The only numbers that you're probably missing are the smaller items like tables and chairs, okay? We can add those in. If you go through that list and you find things that are missing in that report, please let me know.
What about the room dividers in this room? Mm-hmm. I understand one of the dividers can't be used anymore. It's broken and hasn't been fixed.
It hasn't been fixed?
Yes. At least that's the last time I talked to Sherry. She told me the one that I think divides that section can't be divided. I know some of the other club rooms in the Lake of Lava Vista or the other, there are club rooms where the dividers will not stay closed solidly, so it's hard to have two different meetings.
Those are more O&M and operational costs, too. I want to make sure.
But they're costs that we're going to have to spend. They're numbers correct. That are not cheap fixes.
If it's identified, we will take care of it. Okay. So we'll talk about the room dividers. First, I've heard about that. So I want to know how long it's been down and how long it's been that way, and we'll get that fixed and repaired. Okay. But the other thing is, like the smaller items, I will give you a list of punch items. Okay. What I call O&M operational capital, you can put in next year, whatever it is, until you've got to replace those. The bigger ticket items, those are the ones you should be worried about. I think EFG did a good job with Delta in identifying those. McKinsey was the one, and we had now a third reserve company come in, and they basically identified all your big expenditures. That's in that study, okay? It's broken down, useful year life left, and what's remaining, what's long, and also the dollar amount. So it's all there. There's nothing missing. I think your little smaller items, yes they are. We can go through that in detail in the next meeting. And I'll go through and I'll punch out what the cost is, what it looks like.
Small items add up.
And then we can have that. Absolutely, that's what I'm saying, it doesn't. But those are items we can look at, put in the budget, and move things around, okay?
What about the pickleboard? The pickleball court, tennis courts, all of them are complaining about maintenance issues.
That's concerning.
What kind of concerns are they having right now?
You didn't hear the gross? You want to hear Mr. Gross?
I wasn't here. I came in. Sorry, guys. I came in a little bit late.
Jerry, you have a copy.
All right. Thank you.
Apparently, there are multiple issues with courts.
Okay.
And they've been reported multiple times.
For multiple years.
All right. I will look at this, and I'll get back with the pickleball group and other people. But in general,
the other thing I've heard that there is, I'm not sure. I heard this one person that there is a person that has actually filed a lawsuit because they got injured on the baseball field because of all the potholes in the baseball field.
There's nothing that's come through our office, zero. So that is not accurate. Okay. As far as getting that lawsuit.
But I mean, that's something that my understanding is that these are the kind of issues we need to. I think we need a good survey from various clubs, all of the clubs that are running these kinds of things, to get a good idea of what clubs are complaining about the condition of all of our various sports facilities, and to be sure we have a good idea of what we're gonna need to repair once we take over.
Craig, I've got a question. Who's McKinsey Engineering?
And it was another reserve company that we got two other reserve associates, and then McKinsey, and then we had Delta, which that's what provided EFG with that response. We had two other side companies. So I did a comparison of another company next door to them to show kind of the differences between the two companies. And even the third one, I'll put the third one on there, and you'll see a huge difference between all three. It's because they're going in the computer system and looking, saying there's 25, we'll see, you haven't repaired it yet, so you got this much left, it's this much cost.
So how is this gonna be reconciled?
How's it gonna be reconciled? Mm-hmm. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you the reserve study. I've shown you those two, okay? And I'm gonna show you what the useful life is left. If it's in O&M, you probably saw the highlighted graphs, I think Mr. Skip have one there, and we have copies for you guys today that you can take home. Ones that are highlighted less than 5 years, okay? The ones that are pink. Those that are less than 5 years.
I can't see pink and black and white.
Yeah, ours are all gray. You said you have colored ones?
Yeah, we have colored ones right here for you guys.
Got right there.
Gary's got one over there. So, Inja, you guys will get those, but the ones that are highlighted breaks it down and shows 5 years or less and shows what that is, or if it's already covered in O&M, and I can show you where it's covered in O&M as far as those expenditures. So I clean those out, okay? The other items that are still open is where I think you get another reserve company to come in and really sit down with us, sit here with our team, and go through it, and the CDB member can be a part of that. We go through each one of those items to really zero down how much life does it have left, and what that replacement value is, if that makes sense.
And we're gonna see a reserve funding graph, some of that was in the EFG report. That one went negative, if you remember, a couple of years.
And the reason why?
And I personally will not accept anything that goes negative. And if there's not enough money in this, I'm going to have to call for help.
If you look, you know, the next meeting I'll go through really needs to the bottom of the supervisor, you guys will understand. The reason why it went negative, because a lot of the costs that they had in that report is more O&M, but also costs that during this deficiency period.
And if you're going to push it off on O&M and show me that O&M is not going to skyrocket, then maybe I'll look at it.
I will show you that.
We cannot afford our O&M jumping up and down.
Right.
We cannot have a situation where we're going to be giving people a different O&M. People are going to be paying this on an annual basis. They need to be able to have a good solid number on a year-by-year basis. We can't be having jumping up and down.
Why don't you have a private discussion with him and get your point out? I mean, all you're doing is politicking right now.
Yeah.
Before next meeting, send me any questions you have, and then I'll respond to you guys in detail as far as the answer to that. But as far as the survey or the reserve study, I want to get it more sound. It's not sound right now. What you guys have is not a sound reserve study among my kids, okay? So these are the things I want to get sound. The O&M budget, I will show you where we have room for items that are in that current reserve study. Either you can keep in a reserve study, or you can move out of a reserve study, and we can just, like I said, budget long-term for different items. But in general, most of the items too on that list that were in fair condition, I said this to Skip today, have already been taken care of in the EFG report as far as the Delta report that's coming into the inspection. We've taken care of a lot of those items. So that needs to be rectified too as well. And we need to show that difference because a lot of that money that's crunched in has already been taken care of through the operation of getting the club and the amenities ready for sale, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Wasn't that the intent basically today to do all these budget items and
correct. It was
more time to discuss this.
It is.
And now with this minutia watch, it's gonna be clarified, I would think, at the next meeting.
It'll be very clarified. I'm ready for it. My thing is I wanna make sure number one, you guys have time to review it, ask any question you may have, so I'm filled with the questions beforehand versus coming in and doing the presentation and having a barrage of questions. Absolutely, that too. So, there's a reason for it.
Like you said, I think you have to simplify it for us. Dumb it down for us.
I'm doing it. Okay?
We know.
We know.
Every time I'm in
a
meeting, I take my guy.
Keep it simple.
Dumb it down for the board.
Yeah. I will make sure it's very simple for you guys to follow. And if I go over your head, I'll pull you back now. Okay? And thanks, guys.
You're great. You mentioned something just a few minutes ago about Wi-Fi, about Skyping, and it just kind of raised a little bit of a question in my mind, and that is that I know that Sherry and Lifestyles and EV has tried to make the amenities as all-encompassing as possible, but I think that there are times when we have gone in excess. Is an example of just the Dragon Boats, great, great thing. But there were expenditures that were spent on that by AV that gave a select group or a small group of people an amenity or a gift, if you want to call it that, because that's actually what it was, where those same things have not been extended to other groups. And I really think that in doing the evaluation, like the Skype thing, if that's basically a nicety that this club wants to have or other things that a club wants to have, but yet they're not paying for anything, then I think that we need to, at some point in time, say it's not a free ride for everybody, even though we're paying our monthly dues, okay? If clubs want specific items that are just solely associated with that club, maybe we have to take a look at them subsidizing some of it themselves.
Well, Skype is not an expense different than having Wi-Fi.
It's just an example.
We're talking about Wi-Fi.
And real quick, guys, I'll resolve this real quick. As far as the issue with Skype on Wi-Fi, I don't want to go into too much detail. Simple as that, okay? On a Wi-Fi new Skype, it's very difficult to use Skype, period. It doesn't matter where you're.
I understand that. I use Skype all the time.
Yes.
The point I was trying to make is if we have to add cost by expanding in bandwidth, getting more equipment in order to handle it, then that's an expense that we do not have to incur. I totally understand, Rita, that Skype is free. I've been using it for years. Okay? But the thing is, my point is, if we don't have to incur a cost, we shouldn't incur the cost.
Right. And I'll just say the shares of the supervisors over the years, the 6 years since I've been here, we get bombarded with clubs as far as requests of this. And what we do is we put the wish list together. People have heard of the wish list. That wish list is reviewed with Amy Holmes prior to approval of the budget for the next year. And then we go through those live items and say, yes, we're going to do this. So we've been pretty fair across the board. I can tell you as far as the Dragon Boat Club, how that conversation kind of went. It was a new club that came about. It's an amenity that Amy Holmes wanted to buy, like tennis courts, pickleball courts, things like that. So they did go ahead and buy those boats and take care of getting that club operational with those amenities like boats and life jackets and oars and stuff like that. So that was the reason for that and how that came about. And it sounds still absolutely American. Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
You know, I don't usually say stuff, but if the clubs like that are not paying for their own items, why should everybody in this community pay for an item that they cannot use? That don't make any sense. It just doesn't. I'm sitting here, I feel like I'm an idiot, because the way you're doing it is not accurate. They say these chairs are 17 years old. I know that some of these chairs were bought maybe 3 months ago or 3 years ago, because I know what you, I've done it. You can't do this. You've got to have a set program. You can send me something that shows to break down the clubs and break down this and break down the cost. Well, you got to break the course down here and now. You got a club fee for to use the ballroom that night. You got another club fee to use another room. That's fine, but you got to have it broken down, and it's got to be fixed finally. Through the 11 years that I'm living here, I've never been able to worry about getting a room. Then all of a sudden, bang. There's no rooms. We got 200 clubs. There's not going to be no rooms. But you're not going down. You're not taking a figure out of the item that where the repairs will come, the floors will get broke. That'll be there, but the clubs have to pay for it. There has to be a set rule and a set number. That's the only way to make this fair.
Yeah, and that's something as Sydney, I appreciate that. One thing I'll say to you guys is this cell does go through, it goes through. That's up to you guys to set those policies and procedures on which part. So right now, through the end of the home, thank you.
But that also gets to the other issue, the events income. Our events income is $243,320. Our events expenses is $560,975. So the question is, can we get it to the point where our events are closer to a break even? That's $320,000 that is being shared by residents that aren't using the event. They have to pay for it.
We'll go through this in detail, but
That's a question I'd like to
see. I know that's a hot button for you if you brought that up before, and I'll address that at least.
Mr. Chairman, we do have a public hearing that we've noticed for today. Both boards have on the amenity budget. I'd ask that both boards do a motion to open the public hearing. Second, vote to open the public hearing and ask both boards to do that. At that point in time, it'd be fair to take any audience comments on the budget you want, but we're not going to finalize it here today. We're going to continue that in progress until we can have a more formal presentation, and then there'll be another opportunity for public comment after we have that formal presentation, likely in the next meeting. So from a process standpoint, it's important for you to open the public hearing and then not conclude it, but instead continue it in progress until the next board.
We're going to have a public hearing next time also. This is just the legality that we have to do because it's been announced.
Correct. We have to open it today because it's been publicly noticed, and that is items 8, C, and 8, D. We need to open that public hearing today.
And Gary, do you have to advertise that as well?
No, sir. It's already been advertised, and by your action, you continue the public hearing. The public is on notice, and we will post it on the website.
Okay. All right. So, one we've got right now, for the Point Santa CBD, I guess I'll open a public hearing on the 2017-2018 O&M budget.
Yeah, what we do, because we're going to be continuing it, a formal motion to open, which Mr. Zimbardi has just made, he needs a second to vote by the
public. I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Same situation for Point Sienna West CBD, a motion to open the public hearing. Understand will be a continuance for the next meeting. Back on that resolution.
That motion open the public hearing.
I move to open.
Okay. Motion to second. All in favor?
Aye.
At this point, I recommend you take anybody from the public that wants to comment on the budget. But they need to understand too, there'll be a more formal presentation and another opportunity to comment at the next meeting. So, but we want to make this opportunity available because today is the day that we know this one.
Okay. So that being said, are there any people who should make comments on the O&M budget?
Jody Nelson, 567.
Jody Nelson, 567, Shorehaven. Regarding Craig's comments about the capital improvement budget and some of Lita's comments, I noticed that in the agenda there's an estimated replacement data. Are you saying that that is incorrect, what's here, or is not up to date, or?
It needs to be updated.
It needs to be updated, okay. And that will be by before they have to approve the budget?
They're gonna approve the budget and the reserve study. That's something I'm gonna be working on. I'm gonna show them the works of it next month.
Terrific, thanks.
My name's David Roy, 125 Rancho Bronx Drive. Kind of got a long-winded comment on the budget. I've been in favor of this amended purchase from day one. That's been on record. Not just price, that's on record too. But I'm concerned about the process of what we're going through. And I think one of the big things that's biting you guys is that because we're strapped so tight by paying for this thing at the very top end of the range, we have to worry about every little nitpicking detail at this stage is really concerning because it's a very tough format to do this in. You guys can't talk among yourselves outside the meeting. You're having to meet the public and get a lot of details in there. But the problem is you're so tight on the top. And that's why if we were paying the the right amount of money for the amenities, you'd have money in it. You wouldn't be so stressed and trying to do every little detail in this thing in the middle of it. And I think it's good. Obviously, it was a good process. I think AG Home said they paid some of their O&M early, or their money early. But that really should be paid for O&M payments, not the reserve. So we've spent ourselves no reserve, and now we're stressing about every little chair and every little thing in here. And this is going to be a long, hard process. You guys are managing this way. So I'll leave it at that.
Larry Benning, 105 Auburn Drive. One of the things I would ask that you ask the people who prepare the budget to standardize the format so that when we look from year to year, we see the same line item in the budget. I can show you several line items where it was moved from repair and maintenance down to contract services. Next year it goes in back into repair and maintenance or administrative costs. Could we standardize on a format for the budget and stop moving it from year to year to year? The second thing is, as an individual, I look at the budget and I understand the $7 and whatever it is set aside for the reserve fund, but there's $6.42 in additional expenses for my operating costs I can't account for in your budget. That's why earlier I said I recommend you reject this thing, but let me start over. I'll send you an email. Thank you.
Stream
a very high quality if we had the internet capacity. We don't need to call it Skype. We would never use Skype for something as important as that. But there are technology that exists out there that would benefit almost everybody. I just hate to see the whole argument come down to a word like Skype or a particular club. I do not think that represents what we are all trying to achieve. My husband and I have been here for 17 wonderful years, and I don't mind aging in place one little bit, but I don't like it that Sola Vida looks old. I have friends that are moving out to newer places and to older places that stay fresh looking. We do not look fresh. We look old. And I don't know about you, I don't mind so much getting older. I just don't want to live in a place that looks old.
My name is Bill Vann. This is on or not. I live at 394 Skirt Ranch Road. I came here today prepared to go line by line, as I understand there's going to be a significant amount of adjustment before the next meeting. But I did notice, of course, the obvious that this is assuming the amenities were purchased by the city meeting's office.
Microphone.
Yeah, just hold it close.
Is that okay? Can you hear me?
Yeah, that's the way it works.
Oh, okay. I'm not used to talking on microphones. Anyway, the budget, as I printed it out off the website, is impossible to really read. I had to use a magnifying glass to look at each item. And since I'm not going to get down each item, the first observation, obviously, was the reserves going in were not there. And we were almost $500,000 in the hole. And the point that Lita brought up about the events costing more than what they're charging, well, I think that certainly needs to be addressed at some point, because we can't lose $300,000 on special events when it's only a select group of people, maybe 200 or 300 people, perhaps more, that are benefiting. I know initially when I moved into Sola Vida 10 years ago, the restaurant lost $500,000 for a year, and our dues had to go up $13 to cover that $500,000 loss. That was a loss to AV Homes. Well, that was understandable, but at the same time, I don't want to get into situations where a certain group of people are paying for an event, and you're spending more than what you're charging them. And I have to pay for it as well as the other 6,500 people that are in Sola Vida. That doesn't make any sense. There's line items in here that I'll go over at the next meeting, since you're going to make some changes. Some of them are just a matter of, like, I got one item here, dissemination agent fee. Dumb that down. What is that? I mean, I just one item. But I mean, there are items in there like that, agent fee. Significant fees we have to pay, apparently, to be able to even show a movie. I mean, these are things that are unknown to me and probably everybody in this room, but apparently we have to pay them. And one of the questions I have is, are they fixed? Are these fees that can double next year and double the year after that? Do we have like a long-term contract that says there's so much per year? You know, I'm looking forward to having, you know, some new amenities where we'll have a decent theater to watch movies, and I'd be willing to pay for the movie each week if it was a good movie and it costs more to put it on than to give everybody the access to it for free and only 400 or 500 people even use it. That doesn't make sense long term. That's just my opinion. Okay.
This remains your 3 minutes.
Anyway, the next meeting, I intend to go over some of the line items and ask you some of these questions I have about, like, what exactly is that? And is there a contract, or is there no contract on
it? Well, Mr. Mann, we may have the same questions you have. So if you forward them on Mr. Carmichael to be sure you'd be able to respond properly.
I will do that. I will send an email.
I'll check on that, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if there's, once we're done with public comment, we'll need a motion by each board to continue the public hearing in progress to a time date location, sir.
Amy Wilbur, 211 7th and 17th Lane. I attended all 3.5 days of court this past week, and what I have noticed is we pay over $130,000 for an EFG for Mr. Scott Harder's service, and his report went from $58.7 million all the way up to $73.7 million, but the reserve went from $33 million down to zero. And so it has an inverse relationship. And apparently we already paid Delta Engineering to do a reserve study. And now you're saying let's pay it out to somebody else to agree more to do a reserve study. And then apparently Ms. Kathy Leo works magic with AB Holmes and with Delta Engineering. They had a meeting. This all came out in court. They had a meeting after the $33 million reported reserve. And after I don't know how many meetings, and it went down to $10 million. Because you said they don't understand the scope of the work from Delta Engineering. And the only example you gave before was paving the parking lot. I don't know, paving the parking lot costs $23 million. But if they don't understand the scope of the work, if Delta doesn't understand the scope of the work, who gave them the scope of the work to begin with? And then have this $33 million came about and went down $23 million to $10 million, now zero. And we're supposed to buy at the highest price we could pay, and then but we have no reserve. And now we're worrying about reserve and then pay more money for study. And then also the 2016 dues that you're supposed to base on as an income for this purchase price was based on every single lot that was here. $85 times 5,595 lots. And then times 12 months, times 30 years, and you came up with this figure of $73.7 million. When there's 1,400 vacant lots that haven't even been sold, that's not paying any $85 dues. And I figure that's almost $1.5 million difference.